My point here, what their point, what their reasons are, and if we should give to these people or not. Now, reason number one why they are there. They don't know how to spend their money correctly. You know, they're there since they don't have any money. People can give them. All they want to give them 1 million, I don't care. Because if they don't know how to use it, those will stay there. They might spend it on wine, they might spend it on smoking, even drugs if they can find the right person, but they simply don't know how to use it correctly. Point number two, not all beggars have the same reason. Some of the beggars are there since maybe they had a financial crisis, or maybe they had a lawsuit filed against them, in which case they can't recover anymore since they're bankrupt. Or they were just abandoned by whoever loved them and just used to support them through life. Now, these are the kind of people wherein they need money desperately. If you want them to disappear from the streets and stop begging from you, go ahead, give them some. If you're not sure that they're the good people, then sure, be free, don't give them some. But if you are sure that they can use the money correctly, if you are sure that they can recover from their financial crisis and rise to the top again like they used to be, go ahead and give them money. Point number three, there are syndicates on the street. Now, you know those people who just go up to car windows, knock, oh, he has the money. Now, these are the kinds of people that are sent by other people who are hiding somewhere. These people are
in your city, what do you think is the biggest and which should be
projections. Good morning, audience, and good morning, fellow contestants. The question that I got was, do you agree that behavior in school is a reflection of how your parents raise you at home? Allow me to explain this. Now, let me ask you the question. What is behavior to you? What is the importance of behavior? How do you see behavior? Is behavior how you treat another person? Is it how you treat your work? Is it how you deal with everyone? Is it how you deal with everyone? I'll leave that to you. But then, there's good behavior, and there's bad behavior. Am I right? Okay, if you look at this, there's good behavior and bad behavior. What are the parameters of good behavior? Good behavior is when you help. It's when you give what you can. It's when you give what you can to society. It's when you give what helps other people in front of you. It's where it already becomes problematic. To other people, it harms them. It may distract them. It may physically harm them. That it may even cause them injury. So, you see, the line between good and bad behavior is actually a very difficult line. However, because of the time that we have, because of this modern age, behavior has blurred. The line between good and bad has blurred. So no matter how well your parents may raise you, because of how we are exposed to knowledge, because of how we are exposed to this information, because of how we gather, of how we attain these so-called behaviors over the internet, over books, over TV shows, over friends. That's how it really is. And that line has been blurred. When whatever happens, behavior is up to you. It's up to you to choose how you want to treat others. It's to you how you want to choose how to live your life. It's up to you to choose how you behave. Thank you. Thank you for seeing something.
But they are made by God, and we should respect the traditions of God. Third, everything that we have right now has been invented. Like computers, gadgets, they are invented for us to be entertained. But more of these could harm our health and could harm the people's minds. With these things that has been invented, there are good effects and bad effects. Good effects are that, for example, in the hospital, when we are having a heart attack, doctors have machines to treat us. And the bad effects that if we use too much of these gadgets, we are being harmed in our minds and also in our hearts. That's the answer. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone, ladies and gentlemen, judges and students, and also fellow contestants. My name is Nathan Angelo Cruz from grade 7A, and my question for you, my question is, honesty is the most difficult virtue to practice. Agree or disagree? Explain. From the Bible, have you ever heard of the story of Adam and Eve? Of course you are. You're all Christians, if I'm not mistaken, since this is a Christian school anyway. But the Adam and Eve in the story then chose to disobey God and eat the sacred, the fruit of Eden, being dishonest and being tempted by the serpent, which is a manifestation of evil. And thus sets in motion what humanity would call dishonesty from the very start of the human race. And here are 3 points why I think that honesty is the most difficult virtue to practice. First and foremost, as I had said a while ago, it is from the Bible. From the Bible, our ancestors had said, I've been dishonest to themselves and to God. And even their children, Cain and Abel, I've been dishonest to each other and killed and made the labor. And thus, because of this, my second point, it spreads, especially if left unchecked. Since we can't really tell if a person is honest or not, then we wouldn't know if he was honest. And thus, the lies may spread on and on and on until it affects the entire human race. And third, we use honesty for personal. We use dishonesty for personal gain, like what Adam and Eve did. They did it because they want to battle God. They want to be equal to God. They want to be more than God himself. In summary, my 3 points are that it is from the Bible, it spreads, and some people use it for our greater. Now, I hope this is a cornerstone value to be honest at most, if not all of the time, and if possible. Although we cannot be completely dishonest, we should be honest as much as possible. Thank you very much, and again, good morning.
gather ang
mga. Now, at this point in time, we'd like to award the certificates of participation to our contestants. From grade 7. University of St. Lucie Integrated School of Health City, certificate of participation is to certify that Aileen Angelo A. Cruz from 7A has participated in the English Festival 2015 Grade 7 Public Speech Finals, given this 26th day of February 2015 at the University of St. Lucie Integrated School. Signed, Ms. Aileen Angelo.
Thank you.
members of the speaking contest today, appoint the winning target from every judge each time the speaker goes beyond 5 seconds. So our tabulation committee has observed that. Also, before I announce the winners, some points to consider in impromptu would be it is not necessarily willing to walk to watch. You can just stay there and deliver to the center audience your most important points. And impromptu is a contest for the brightest, it's a contest for the intelligent people. It's a contest for question and answer, so it requires thinking. I would like to start with the third place. The third place for today's public speaking contest goes to contestant number 8, Sid Dalimon from 7. The second place is from grade 9, 19, Tara. Chose the first place as Keeper Susan from A. So these are our winners for today, Sam Dalimon, Tara Jada, and Keeper Susan. Congratulations.
Congratulations to today's winners of the Prompt to Speech Conference.